everyone. Nice to meet you again. Welcome back to my third video session, and hope you're all doing good and taking necessary care during the COVID lockdown time. Let's stay safe and then let's together win the COVID and then get back to normal rhythm. Yeah. And this video is going to be a subject wind turbine measurements, and we started with aerodynamics and then we moved on to wind turbine aeroelastic simulation, and then this topic is wind turbine measurements. So the reason why I took wind turbine measurements, I thought there is a connection in the sequence. We started with aerodynamics and then moved on to aeroelastic simulation, which is modeling of a wind turbine in the computer, and then comes the measurements. So one should also know how to measure all the parameters what we simulated. So therefore I thought measurements could be the right subject after the simulation. And this is going to be an overall study or overall outlook of the wind turbine measurements. And then later on in the upcoming videos, we can deep dive into every individual measurements. So that will be the plan. Come, let's get into the subject. Yeah. So like last time, this time also I have listed down the subtopics so that we don't miss it. And the subtopics are, so this is just to show that we started from simulation and then now we are learning about the wind turbine measurements. Yeah, and this is a picture which gives the instrumentation setup to do a wind turbine measurement, so keep that aside. And then now let's see the subtopics. So this video will cover the need of the measurements, what are the needs, and then what are the tests that are going to be carried out on wind turbine, and then what are the standards that govern the whole process of testing of wind turbine, and then what is the duration of measurements, and what is the instrumentation setup needed, and then who can do the measurements. Is it that everyone can do, is a OEM can do, or a wind farm developer can do, or is there agencies who can only do it? So that's about who can do the measurements. So I think this will give a broad picture of what is wind turbine measurements and how it goes on. Yeah, okay, so it's about the needs. So need is basically to understand why do we need this measurement, and as I listed here, there are three needs. One is to know how your performance of the turbine, to know how the mechanical loading of your turbine. So it is basically as a designer, as a or as an OEM or as a wind turbine manufacturer, you need to know how it behaves, how it performs, how it produces the power, what kind of load acts on the turbine and the components. So that's the know-how process. And then the second and third are the certification and warranty. So like any product in this world, starting from a pen, pencil, to the hi-fi spacecraft and so on, everything in this world, in this engineering world, needs testing and certification. Likewise, wind turbine product is also a product which has several standards, very well developed standards, wherein which guides us to do testing and certification process. So that is also for certification and testing, you naturally need some measurements to be done, and that is also one of the need where you need to do wind turbine measurements. And then the third one is the warranty commitment from the OEM to the wind farm developer. So the wind farm owner, when he buys a turbine from the OEM, the original equipment manufacturer, which in this case the wind turbine manufacturer, so the turbine manufacturer gives a kind of commitment that my turbine will produce so and so power. So this needs to be verified in the field, wherein a power curve measurement by an independent body has to be carried out. So this is what I have written as the warranty negotiation. So for that also you need to do a measurement. So these are the three basic needs why you need to do a wind turbine measurements. And then, okay, what are the tests? So what are the measurements that are basically done on a wind turbine? So this is all about the turbine measurement, and this does not consider the component level testing. Like there is a process called gearbox testing, there is a activity called rotor blade testing, where a static test and a dynamic test on the blades are carried out. And then there is a back-to-back generator testing, there is a inverter testing. So a lot of component level testing are there, but this is mainly focusing on wind turbine measurements, the overall wind turbine testing. Yeah, okay, so the tests are mechanical load measurements, safety and functional testing, power curve measurements. So these three are written on the first line. There is a difference. So these are the ones which are mainly needed for type testing when you want to certify your product. When you, after designing a product, after the design assessment certificate issued by a certification body, then the product goes on, then the product in the drawing, in the paper, it goes to a prototyping. then the prototype product is made and then taken to a field where a complete product type testing, prototype testing, which we call it PTT, is carried out, and for which these are the basic tests to do to get a prototype testing evaluation done. So mechanical load measurements, safety and functional testing, power curve measurements. And then these three are mostly optional modules, optional testing, which talks about the power quality or electrical characteristics. So power quality measurements, low voltage right through, high voltage right through, and this is the noise measurement. So these four are optional measurements, and these three are essential, which are called as type testing measurements. But of course, there is nothing wrong. You can also combine these measurements during a prototype testing process. The prototype testing process goes on normally for 6 to I would say even 12 months, because you need to collect all the data sets, sufficient data sets needs to be collected, and therefore it goes completely for 6 to 12 months, almost a year. And in Indian perspective, we can say one wind season, starting from April to September, where you cover all the low wind measurements to the high wind measurements. So you need to have your turbine put under measurements from April to September to collect all the data that you need to analyze for all these measurements. Yeah. And these are the standards that govern every measurements, like IEC 61400-13, which is the guideline to do mechanical load measurements, and IEC 61400-01, which is more relevant, and it acts as a guideline to do the safety and functional testing. Of course, these two are naturally combined, because these two measurements mostly talk about the mechanical loads and the behavior of the turbine to various wind conditions. So what we did in the simulation, in the aeroelastic simulation, what load cases we simulated, which are called as the design load cases, like a normal stop, emergency stop, a grid failure condition, a runaway, overspeed, cable twist conditions, vibrational sensor triggering. So we did various type of simulations in the process of aeroelastic simulation, which we called as DLCs. And similarly here, in order to verify all the design load cases, not all DLCs can be verified, but certain DLCs, whichever is possible to test in the field, we try to do a testing here. We can easily trigger a normal stop in the turbine and then see how it behaves. You can easily trigger an emergency stop and then see how it behaves. So these are called as MLCs, measurement load cases. So there are certain DLCs which are related to, which are connected with MLCs, and these MLCs can be tested during this process of safety and functional testing, and also as part of the mechanical load measurements. And power curve measurements is governed by 12-1 standard, IEC 61400-12-1, and this is more about the power curve measurements, which is the wind speed versus power. Everyone knows it is like when you want to qualify an automobile, normally people talk about mileage, so kilometer per hour, and then maybe we talk about the speed and then pickup. So similarly, when someone wants to qualify a wind turbine, it is normally based on the power curve. What is the power curve performance of this turbine, for what wind speed, what power it delivers. So, and how is that done? And this is basically with this measurements, power curve measurements, for which you need to have a typical setup like this, which we get into it later. Okay, so that's the power curve measurements, and power quality, low voltage right through, and HVRT. These three are related to grid electrical characteristics, how it behaves to various conditions from the grid, whether the voltage changes, whether it goes to low voltage or high voltage, how it behaves, and then for various conditions, or how this turbine creates problem to the grid, that is also studied in this. So power quality measurement talks about voltage, step factor, flicker coefficients for various short circuit currents. So this is all what kind of impact that this induction machine, basically wind turbine is an induction machine, and when it is connected to grid, it creates a lot of problems, which we all know. And even as a synchronous machine with permanent magnets also could create a problem, because it's a megawatt class turbine, when it is connected to grid can always create a lot of harmonics and things like this. So all these are studied in the power quality measurements. And LVRT and HVRT needs a different kind of setup, not a normal setup like this is sufficient, and it needs a big container, a 20 feet or 40 feet container with all the capacitance and the resistor banks, which can do a triggering of very low voltage, and also to do a testing of high voltage, it also needs to boost the voltage. So it acts as a grid. So that's we call it as a grid simulator, which is stored in a, without disturbing the actual grid, we try to simulate it. We try to trigger it with the help of this equipment which is stored in this container. So that's the setup needed for these two measurements. And as I told, these are optional ones, but still it is good to have it tested. As a product owner, as a designer and a manufacturer, you need to know the electrical characteristics of a turbine. So I would treat it as an essential measurement in today's context, where we talk about grid quality, grid parity, and where several renewable systems are connected in the electrical grid network, where we talk about smart grid solutions. So therefore, it is highly important to do all the three measurements also during the stage of type testing. And then the next one, and the governing standard is IEC 61400-21 for all the three measurements. And then the next one is the noise measurement, which is IEC 61400-11, which is the acoustic noise measurement standard. And here it is also also important in a context where you need to ensure that the noise created by your turbine rotor blades are within certain limit, and normally the limit is 106.4 decibel, and today's blades with the RPM of 1214 RPM and a blade length of 65 to 70 meters can naturally have a tip speed. The speed at the tip can naturally go up to 200 kilometers per hour. So you can imagine what will be the noise that gets generated at the tip. So therefore it becomes highly essential to ensure that my turbine doesn't make such a noise wherein it doesn't create problem to the living neighborhood nearby. So that's something that needs to be tested, and that is this noise measurement. And for this you need this setup. And added to this, you need to keep a mic here. So at the back of the turbine, at H plus D by 2 distance, you need to keep a mic and then keep measuring for various turbine operating modes, and then ensure that the noise levels are lesser. And what kind of instruments to be used, what kind of analysis to be performed, what kind of parameters to be reported in the measurement report, all these are well explained in this standard, and this is from IEC. And then duration of measurements. Yeah, it depends upon the individual measurements, like mechanical load measurements and power curve measurements can go together. And it needs a typical setup like this, where you have a meteorological mast the same height of the hub height of the turbine, and you have a primary and secondary anemometer, and you have a wind vane for measuring the wind direction, and then you have various other meteorological parameters to measure humidity, temperature and pressure, and also the rain condition. And all these are connected to a data acquisition system or a data logger here. And similarly, from the turbine, you have various parameters measured. You have the mechanical sensors, which are the strain gauges, which are based on the Wheatstone bridge. So you have those strain gauges mounted on the blade root on all the three blades, which is used to measure the edgewise and the flapwise moments. And then on the main shaft, you always have to mount three Wheatstone bridge strain gauges, which used to measure the shaft X and Y, and also the shaft torsional moments. And on the tower top, you have two bridges again to measure the, you need to have three Wheatstone bridge. One is to measure the tilt moment, the other is the yaw moment, and also the tower top torsion. So three bridges here. And then on the bottom, you have two bridges. One is for measuring the tilt moment, and the other is to measure the sideways moment, or it is called the yaw moment. So, which is very important here. So, this is the mechanical sensors. And apart from this, electrically, you need to have CTs, current transformers, and potential transformers to measure the electrical power, grid frequency, reactive power produced by the turbine. That all those sensors are mounted in the tower bottom, and then all these sensors are again connected to the central data acquisition system, which is basically a PC based system which has very high sample frequency, and the sampling frequency for various measurements are again mentioned in the standard. And like for power curve measurements, you need to have at least 1 Hz of sampling. And for power quality, it is somewhere in the range of kilohertz, to capture the sudden transience of the current when the turbine cuts in and cuts out. So you need to have a higher level of sampling frequency. So therefore, it is very good to have a PC-based measurement system wherein you can change the sampling frequency based on the measurements that you are conducting. So that's about the measurement setup, and that's the instrumentation what we need, and also the accuracies of every sensor is also mentioned in the standard, respective standard. And then coming to the final point, who can do the measurements? So it depends upon the purpose. If you're doing it for the know-how, then you as an OEM or a designer can do your own measurements. You can do your own mounting of sensors, and then you can measure and then see, you can optimize your turbine performance. You can perfectly do it. But when it comes to the process of certification or checking the warranty class, then it is good to go with it is mandated to go with an accredited measurement laboratory, which is accredited according to IEC 17025 standard for the measurement and testing laboratories. So only these labs can really do a measurement for the purpose of certification and warranty. Yeah, I think with this you would have got a broad picture of what is wind turbine measurements. And in the next video, in the next upcoming videos, we can get into each one of these measurements and then see what instruments are needed, what kind of analysis are performed, how long is the measurements, and then what are the essential things that need to be reported or presented to the end user of the measurement results, and so on. Yeah. Okay. So thanks for watching. And once again, I thank you everyone, the viewers, for giving a nice reception of the information that I'm giving, and also good comments are being received. I'm really thankful for that. And please take care. We'll stay tuned.